My name is Ginger Spitzer. I'm the executive director for the Foundation for Sarcoidosis Research. As you know, we're the hosts of the conference. First and foremost, I want to thank you all for coming out. As many of us, who are somehow connected to this disease, you know that just getting up and getting out can be a bit of a hassle sometimes. So just coming up this morning, we're really applaud you and hope that we can make it worth your while with some information and hopefully a little bit of inspiration as well. As far as the agenda, I'm going to grab mine. So the plan is that we do have a wonderful speaker today, a patient speaker who will be coming up here right after me. Then we have four different presentations with different physicians, sarcoidosis experts, who can hopefully give some insight into the disease. And then we will have a short break, and then we'll come back for the Q&A session, which is really, and we'll remind you right before the Q&A session, but it's really around getting a better understanding of your disease. You know, we do shy away from, we're not trying to give anybody a diagnosis or any medical advice or things like that, but it's definitely something that will make you, that can connect you directly to a physician who works all the time in sarcoidosis. And then after that, we have we'll have lunch, and lunch will include a patient engagement session. So it's a way that FSR is able to kind of connect patients together, but also hear the patient voice about the burden of this disease and exactly, you know, what is life like and what are the things that people up the chain, you know, beyond even physicians, but development, drug development, et cetera, that need to hear about this particular disease. And then we hopefully can convey those messages in the ways that we're able. So again, welcome. Hopefully it's not too hot in here. It's always going to be too hot in here, but hopefully it'll remain a little cool. There's water in the back, and as I said, we'll have a really good lunch, so you have something to look forward to as well. Okay, so the first thing I'd like to do is introduce our patient speaker. Alan Birkenhammer is a patient as well as an advocate for sarcoidosis patients. He's very involved with our foundation, and we welcome him and thank him for coming to speak to patients. Alan?
Good morning. Sarcoidosis, a condition of unknown cause characterized by clumps of inflammatory cells called granulomas that hang out in places in your body that you really don't want them. I have sarcoidosis, and for me, the place they hang out in my body is in my heart. At first, I didn't know I had sarcoidosis, and in fact, I had never heard of it. All I knew is that I was having trouble when I was riding my bike with my buddies that turned into trouble climbing a flight of stairs, that turned into trouble walking to the kitchen to get a drink of water. After diagnosis, I had a pacemaker implanted in my chest. You see, in me, sarcoidosis interferes with my heart's ability to beat properly. I had a special kind of pacemaker that can prevent a certain bad type of heartbeat that could kill me. A few months after the surgery, I received a letter from my insurance company telling me that I did not need this special pacemaker because they had no clinical proof that it was necessary. Now, the returns desk in a hospital is very hard to find. Even harder to find than the cafeteria. And the insurance company told me that since there was no clinical evidence, no studies that spelled out that sarcoidosis patients need this type of pacemaker, that they just weren't going to pay for it. Now, the good news for me is that my heartbeats are starting to be much more normal. And that's because I found a doctor with experience in treating sarcoidosis who treats me with a great deal of compassion. We've experimented with a number of different drugs in different quantities and always checking my blood for signs of improvement and taking special scans of my chest. When my doctor wanted to try a stronger and therefore more expensive drug, my insurance company once again denied the treatment, saying that this drug was not used for sarcoidosis and that there were no clinical studies. You see, in order to do clinical studies, you need a fair number of patients, and for good or for bad in my case, sarcoidosis is pretty rare, especially sarcoidosis that's just in your heart. Now, the Foundation for Sarcoidosis Research gives me, as a patient, a voice. The Foundation for Sarcoidosis Research has a registry where patients can identify when they were diagnosed, where the granulomas are in their bodies, what type of medication they take, and patients can even ask to be part of clinical studies. The Foundation for Sarcoidosis Research provides funds for clinical studies so that researchers can look for causes for this condition and how best to treat it. So whether you're here today because, like me, you are a patient, or maybe you love or take care of a patient, or maybe you're just interested in learning more about sarcoidosis, I thank you for coming. I welcome you to the event, and I appreciate your support for the Foundation for Sarcoidosis Research. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. And one of the points that Alan touched on is kind of a theme for us, which is, how to communicate what is happening to sarcoidosis patients and get that data that people need, that industry needs to, and academia needs to focus on it as a specialty and as a study to get some answers. So I'd like to introduce our first physician speaker. We have Dr. Chen. He's from Johns Hopkins University right here in Baltimore. Dr. Chen is also, his site has been selected as one of the clinical studies networks for FSR, which I can talk a little bit about later. But thank you again for being here, Doctor.
All right. Well, thanks. I'd like to thank the FSR for this opportunity to talk about how we think about sarcoidosis.
And so, just as a quick overview, as many of you have probably have read about, sarcoidosis was first described, say, in the late 1800s, and these first descriptions are often attributed to Dr. Jonathan Hutchinson from England and Dr. Carl Beck from Sweden, where both physicians had described a series of patients who had these strange purplish lesions in their skin. And approximately 30 years after that, the nephew of Carl Beck, Caesar Beck, basically recognized and wrote about patients where he found evidence of sarcoidosis in other parts of their bodies. So, I mean, why should we be concerned about sarcoidosis? Actually, the NIH Office of Rare Disease Research still lists sarcoidosis as potentially a rare disease. But there are some experts that suggest or have, studied and estimated that the lifetime risk to develop sarcoidosis in the Western world, in the United States or Western Europe, is approximately 1-3%. And I believe that sarcoidosis, because it tends to occur or happen in young adulthood, this presents a significant socioeconomic burden because it may really have an impact on that person's work productivity, starting at that age. And then if you were to set aside other lung diseases such as COPD, asthma, lower respiratory tract infection, sarcoidosis actually rises to be a significant cause for healthcare utilization in the United States. And as we know, for patients who experience many years of disease sarcoidosis activity in their lungs, leading to significant scarring, those patients actually have a high chance of passing away from this disease. And so the actual number of cases of sarcoidosis is actually not very well known, and there are a variety of estimates, but one of the reasons that this number is not clearly defined is that many cases of sarcoidosis are sort of incidentally found, that essentially the diagnosis is stumbled upon. And so just to give some examples of how we might use some of these numbers, we can use a couple of different examples. So for example, in asthma, as we know, is a pretty common disease in the United States. The numbers, just rough numbers, would be that approximately 400 cases of asthma per 100,000 population are diagnosed per year, so that's sort of the incidence of asthma. And because asthma really doesn't kill patients very quickly, those patients will linger, and so that accounts for the high prevalence or the total number of cases of asthma at any one given time. And in the United States, it's estimated that maybe about 7% of the population has asthma. On the other hand, lung cancer does, unfortunately, kill people rather quickly, and so the prevalence or how many cases of lung cancer, you know, at any one given time is much lower. So with sarcoidosis, it's sort of in between in that the yearly rate or incidence of sarcoidosis is not felt to be that high, approximately 20 cases per 100,000 population. But like asthma, you know, sarcoidosis generally doesn't kill people very quickly. And so these cases will linger on over years. And so some experts have estimated that perhaps there may be as many as 1 million patients with sarcoidosis in the United States. But again, the exact number is not very well defined. And so, as you may, many of you have maybe have experienced, particularly in our patient population in the United States, many patients do experience many years of chronic long-term disease activity. And it's estimated maybe one out of every three patients, roughly in the United States, may be in this category. And the problem with this is that, certainly this will lead to longer courses of therapy and, you know, the possibility of problems associated with that as well. And it may take a few years for a patient to really, and their physician to kind of fully understand what the extent of that person's new diagnosis of sarcoidosis might mean. For some patients who, particularly those who experience what we call acute sarcoidosis, they might experience remission of the disease after a few years. But for many patients who experience many decades of chronic active sarcoidosis, they may be at risk of developing scarring. Sometimes we use the word fibrosis in the lungs. And so, and what may be happening in their lungs is sort of easily seen if we take a look at what biopsies of the lung may look like, where instead of the normal wispy air-filled lung, we find in patients with sarcoidosis that their lung has been replaced by these bulky granulomas, sort of shown here in blue, outlined by areas of scarring, highlighted by this red dye that kind of shows collagen in these samples. And so, you know, I know that all of you that are here today are either have sarcoidosis or know somebody with sarcoidosis. One thing that may be important is that just to try to make sure that we're all sort of like, you know, speaking the same language, so to speak. And so many of you, including with the patient from the beginning, mentioned that you've been probably all told that sarcoidosis is caused by inflammation, that sarcoidosis causes granulomas, and at least trying to make sure that we all understand what both inflammation and granulomas mean. Will make it easier for you to understand how we as your doctors think about sarcoidosis. And I think that as illustrated by Alan in the beginning, that the one thing I know that most of the patients understand best is really what their own experience with sarcoidosis has been. So sarcoidosis certainly can make people feel sick, obviously. It can certainly cause a breathing problem in some patients. It can cause aches and pains that could be very debilitating in some patients. And then, like in the first descriptions of sarcoidosis, in some patients, it may cause a problem that you can actually see in your skin. The one thing that actually, just like what Alan had mentioned in the beginning, is that in patients who have active sarcoidosis, in most cases, we can at least control the disease with medications. Unfortunately, for those patients who may have experienced many years of active sarcoidosis that may lead to permanent damage or scarring of certain parts of the body, unfortunately, no medications can fix that, fix scarring once it sets in. So let's get back to this issue about sarcoidosis being described as a disease that involves inflammation. So what does that mean? Inflammation generally just simply means that, or describes a disease that involves activity of the immune system. And so, to try to understand what that means, I find it useful sometimes to talk about maybe the most common immune system disease as an example, which would be allergies. And so I think we've all had contact with other people with allergies. Maybe some of you also have allergies in addition to your sarcoidosis. So as we know, allergies is another disease that involves activity of the immune system. And allergies represent a situation, generally speaking, where a person's immune system gets stimulated by certain exposure to certain things in the environment, such as pollens or animal dander. But one important thought would be that these types of exposures are essentially everywhere, and they only cause problems in a few number of people who actually do come down with allergies. Now, the substances that may set off a person's allergies, we give a special name called antigens. All right, and you may have heard of, for example, ragweed as a common antigen for allergies. All right, what this doesn't mean, as we know, ragweed doesn't cause allergies in everybody, but it's the one that at least commonly may trigger some people's allergies. And again, ragweed, like many other things that might set off allergens in some individuals, ragweed is basically everywhere. Many people have contact with it. But in reality, most people who are exposed to ragweed don't really have any reactions to it, okay? And on the other hand, there are certainly some patients who have very severe allergies to ragweed and other things. And the other issue to kind of think about is that repeated exposures to ragweed from the environment or just simply living with a cat, for example, will not make a person have allergies. We think that there's something that is genetically different about these patients' immune system that sort of predisposes them to being able to having allergic responses. It's almost as if these people are essentially kind of born to have allergies. So when the immune system is stimulated in allergies, one important thing that does happen is that the immune system actually makes a special chemical signal called histamine. And histamine actually causes itchy eyes, runny nose, and many of the symptoms that we know and identify as an allergic response. When the immune system is stimulated in allergies, the other thing that happens is that white blood cells are also become active. And some of these white blood cells may travel through the bloodstream and end up in the skin causing a rash or hives, maybe travel to the back of the nose and throats of other allergy sufferers. And so, when patients who suffer from allergies have their immune system stimulated, two important things that happen would be the production of important chemical signals like histamine, the activation of white blood cells, and also it causes the immune system to make something called antibodies. And this is just simply another weapon that the immune system uses to fight bad things. And so, after talking a little bit about what about allergies as an example of immune system disease, we can bring many of these thoughts back to how we think about sarcoidosis. So again, sarcoidosis is a disease caused by inflammation, basically increased activity of the immune system. We believe that in sarcoidosis, when the immune system is active, this leads to the production of certain chemical signals that the immune system uses to do what it needs to do. We think many of the symptoms that patients experience are due to the effects of these chemical signals, and that the chemical signals will cause white blood cells to become active. Some of these white blood cells basically, again, travel through the bloodstream. And in sarcoidosis, these white blood cells may find their way into organs typically involved with sarcoidosis, like, for example, the lung, in some cases the heart. And they gather to form these clusters of white blood cells that we can find underneath the microscope and identify as granulomas. That's essentially what we're looking for. And the actions of both the chemical signals and the active white blood cells can damage organs. And with enough time, sometimes this damage does lead to scarring, some permanent changes. And so, unlike allergies, where we have a list of antigens, such as ragweed, cat, dander, and such, that with allergies, we have a list of things that we are known to trigger allergies in some patients. What is missing with the story of sarcoidosis would be a list of antigens that have been proven to trigger sarcoidosis. So this actually ends up being a focus of a lot of research in sarcoidosis, which is to see if we can discover antigens or things that might be stimulating sarcoidosis in patients. And so one way to think about or maybe look for what might be triggering sarcoidosis in some patients if we were to review a classic skin test that was once used many years ago to screen for sarcoidosis. And so this test is often attributed to a Norwegian doctor named Angsar Kvim. And his work basically confirmed that if you made an extract from sarcoidosis tissues, usually the spleen, and injected into the skin of patients with sarcoidosis, that majority of patients, about over 80%, would then form granulomas from that injection site. And if you then biopsied it, that tissue extract would be making causing granulomas to form in the skin. That these granulomas look almost identical to ones you typically see in a regular sarcoidosis biopsy. So what this shows is that there's something in diseased tissue that was used to make the combined skin test. There's something in diseased tissues that's actually causing granulomas to form in sarcoidosis. So our research group at Hopkins, led by Dr. David Moeller, we wanted to try to answer a question. Is it possible to identify an antigen that might be causing the immune system responses in this confined skin test? So what we did was we made our own confined extracts using sarcoidosis lymph node biopsies. And we took this material and we ran a special test called a Western blot. And what this means is that we put the material on a gel. And this process separates the different proteins in that mixture, much like how we might line up clothes along a clothesline. And then we expose the gel to blood samples we obtained from sarcoidosis patients. And about 50% of the blood samples that we tested, these patients had antibodies in their blood that was targeting a protein in this tissue extract, such as what is circled here on the picture. We did a little bit more detective work using mass spectrometry, and we found that this this band on the gel lined up with a protein called catalyzed peroxidase, and we shortened it using the nickname MCATG. So at least to suggest that there are patients who seem to be mounting immune response to something in these tissue extracts. In a different set of experiments, we try to see if we can look for chemical signals that might be involved with the immune system response in sarcoidosis. And essentially what we found was evidence of serum amyloid A, abbreviated here as SAA, and that SAA is a naturally occurring protein that we found to be highly concentrated in many sarcoidosis granulomas on biopsies. We didn't find evidence of SAA in other inflammatory diseases of the lung, and this suggests that perhaps accumulation of SAA in sarcoidosis might be special in sarcoidosis. And importantly, in some other experiments, we found that SAA could act as a chemical signal to stimulate white blood cells, immune cells from patients with sarcoidosis. So, at least from the last few slides, I've shown an inkling of as to how we think about sarcoidosis. We think that sarcoidosis basically, or the important features and secrets of sarcoidosis are locked in the granulomas. And by studying that, we think we've picked out a couple of insights or thoughts as to why sarcoidosis happens in some patients. We think that that sarcoidosis, again, is a disease that involves increased activity of the immune system, that this activity of the immune system may be triggered by certain antigens, like MCATG. We know that the story of MCATG, of sarcoidosis doesn't end here. Certainly that MCATG or this discovery of MCATG is probably just the tip of the iceberg and probably is just the first of other antigens yet to be discovered. And the important issue with the MCATG is that that it by itself is probably not the only reason why people have sarcoidosis. There's probably must be other genetic differences in the person's immune system to allow them to actually have the disease, even with repeated exposures to this. And like with allergies, in sarcoidosis, we believe that there are important chemical signals that are involved in why this disease causes all the problems it does, and perhaps that we have some results to show that SAA may be important chemical signals for this disease. So even with this, it still leaves some important questions yet to be answered. You know, for example, who is experiencing sarcoidosis, and why does sarcoidosis seem to behave differently in different people? And so, again, like we had mentioned before, like, you know, all of you here today either have sarcoidosis or know somebody else who has sarcoidosis. But I think everyone in the room here today has come to see, to basically help us all learn more about sarcoidosis. And this actually would be one issue that patients could really help us with. As I mentioned before, you know, the number and variety of cases of sarcoidosis, even in the United States, is not well understood. And so efforts like the Foundation for Sarcoidosis Research, SARC patient registry, would be an easy way that that patients can actually participate and actually help us learn who has sarcoidosis. And hopefully, if we know who has sarcoidosis, we can then learn why they're having this disease as well. I'd like to mention another type of research project. This is something called the grad study that you may have, some of you may have heard of. This is a study sponsored by the NIH. And the goal of this study was a little bit different in that what this study was trying to address would be to see what type of microbe exposures patients with sarcoidosis may be exposed to. And the grad study was trying to see if differences in the patient's lung microbiome essentially might account for differences in the course of sarcoidosis might take from one patient to the next. And this was an important study in that it was trying to match up samples from individual patients, that is, you know, the microbial samples from each individual patients, with an analysis of their gene expression, and matching that up with that each person's medical information. So hopefully this would provide some additional insight as to, again, why sarcoidosis might be different from one patient to the next. And we believe that studies like this, where we sort of are matching up different types of information from individual people, that this might be the first important step towards what you may have heard of as individualized medicine. And we hope that the results from the study might allow us new ways for detecting sarcoidosis, and that this might also lead to new ways of treating sarcoidosis. And what I mean by this is that, for example, if studies like GRADS helps us prove that either MCAT-G or other antigens are actually important in triggering the inflammation in sarcoidosis, this may lead to new ways of testing for sarcoidosis, perhaps a newer, safer version of the old combined skin test, and that might allow for us to confirm sarcoidosis even without a biopsy in some situations. If the results from research again prove that the immune responses to MCAT-G and other antigens actually are the main driving force of behind the inflammation sarcoidosis, then this also opens the possibility of new ways of treating it, much like, for example, how we might treat patients with allergies with allergy shots, where the allergy shots, prevent the immune system from reacting to the ragweed anymore. We can basically try to pattern that that method, for sarcoidosis, perhaps. And we could also imagine using essentially combining forces that perhaps through the patient registries, by learning who has sarcoidosis, that might be able to guide and design how we might tackle these new ideas that are come up from the scientific research like the grad study. So I'd like to probably end here. Basically, hopefully, this gives you a little bit of insight as to how we think about sarcoidosis. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Chen. Next, we have Dr. Rossman, who's from University of Pennsylvania, and Dr. Rossman will be doing a presentation on treatment options.
I want to thank Ginger and FSR for inviting me to come here today, and also Mallinckrodt and Gilead for sponsoring this patient session. As I think Ed had mentioned about when he was talking about what is sarcoid, he didn't really say what it is, because we really don't know what sarcoid is. And this certainly creates a problem when we're trying to talk about treatment, since there is no specific cause of sarcoid. The treatment is sort of non-specific in that sense. So it's important to realize that one, treatment is not always necessary in sarcoid. There's a high rate of spontaneous recovery in certainly a newly diagnosed sarcoid. And generally, Ed didn't talk about this too much in sarcoid, but there are many different manifestations of sarcoid. I mean, some people have pulmonary disease, which is probably the most common form of sarcoid. But as Alan was talking about, he has cardiac disease, which is treated slightly different than pulmonary sarcoid. people can have severe CNS disease. Certainly the founder of the Foundation for Sarcoid Research has CNS disease, and that's certainly treated a little bit differently than either pulmonary or cardiac sarcoid. people can have elevated calciums. They can have severe pain syndromes. So there are many different manifestations of sarcoid. And unfortunately, all these are treated slightly differently, so it makes it a little bit difficult talking about treatment options. Generally, we don't treat people with sarcoid unless they're having significant symptoms from it. So if they have critical organ involvement, certainly of their brain, their eyes, the heart, or elevated calciums, they probably require treatment. We tend to only treat lung involvement when there's significant lung involvement, because a minor degree of lung involvement, the treatment may be worse than actually the disease. So generally, if people have a significant progressive loss of function or a significant decline of their vital capacity, then we would start treatment. But just finding a spot on the x-ray itself does not indicate that people need treatment. And certainly, if people have significant impairment of the quality of their life, either through significant skin lesions, there's this form of sarcoid known as lupus pernio, where people get very disfiguring lesions of their face. Fatigue can be a huge problem in sarcoid, where people just have no energy to do anything and can be very difficult to treat. And then there are also these pain syndromes that people with sarcoid have that, again, can be very difficult to treat. All these things are treated slightly differently, so I can't really talk about specific treatment plans. But it's important that treatment should relieve certainly the symptoms that somebody has and improve that person's quality of life, because that's really what we're interested in, is the quality of life that somebody has. And the drugs that do this should have, hopefully, the fewest side effects. So in any treatment regimen for somebody with sarcoid, it's an organ approach to therapy, depending on which organ is requiring to be treated, and to use a graded approach to treatment, where we increase the treatment depending upon the side effects of the drugs and the efficacy of the drugs. So generally, one would start with non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs if somebody has some presents with erythema nodosum, which are red lesions on their tibia and ankle pain. Generally, this can be treated with non-steroidal inflammatory drugs and will quickly go away, or maybe a short course of steroids. Corticosteroids have been traditionally the standard therapy of choice, first drug of choice used in sarcoid, but we all know that corticosteroids have huge numbers of side effects. And with large doses of corticosteroids, generally the people's quality of life may not be improved by the use of these drugs. but they certainly have, and I'll review some of this, been effective in treating sarcoidosis. Anti-metabolites, methotrexate, azathioprine, mycophenolate, sort of a second line course of treatment when corticosteroids either are not effective or are producing too many side effects. While the side effects from these drugs are more serious, if you get them, than that of corticosteroids, they're relatively unusual. And then more recently, biological agents, the anti-TNF drugs and anti-B cell therapy, have been used more recently to treat sarcoidosis when other means of treatment have failed. Because of the different manifestations of sarcoid, the different organs, FSR organized an expert group of opinion to get leaders in the field. I've listed them here, Bob Boffman from Cincinnati, Mark Judson, who's now up at Rochester, myself, Lisa Meyer, National Jewish, Marjolaine Den from the Netherlands, Barney Stern is here in Baltimore as a neurologist, David Muller is at Johns Hopkins, and Dan Culver from the Cleveland Clinic, got these physicians together to sort of develop different treatment strategies for the various manifestations of sarcoid. And it's too complicated to give in a 15-minute presentation here, but this is the website that gives these treatment options, starting from the most simplest treatment to the sort of more serious treatment that you can use, for, depending on whether it's skin, liver, lungs, eyes, brain, and I think it goes through all the various manifestations of sarcoid. There have also been some evidence-based reviews of certainly the use of corticosteroids in sarcoid. Generally, evidence-based reviews are based on placebo-controlled trials. Placebo-controlled trials are sort of the standard that people use today to evaluate the efficacy of any new drugs for the treatment of diseases, and is certainly the standard by which the FDA approves drugs for the use of drugs in diseases today. And unfortunately, there have been very few placebo-controlled trials in sarcoid. There were some initial studies, and I'll review them in a second, which showed some initial effects of steroids, but no long-term benefit. And that's certainly a problem when we get to drugs beyond steroids. There have really been no placebo-controlled trials of use of the secondary or tertiary drugs in sarcoid. There, well, the TNF drugs, there have been, and I'll review them briefly, but they're limited use. The initial studies that were done to show the efficacy of steroids were really done in the 1960s and done by four different sites. James in England, Israel in Philadelphia, Slerus in the Netherlands, and Zaki in New York all did initial studies in placebo-controlled trials with a variety of doses of corticosteroids, prednisone, as you can see here, somewhere between 5 and 40 milligrams a day of prednisone for various periods of time, between 3 months and 2 years. And all these were, some of these studies were evaluated at the end of treatment, but most of them were evaluated years after treatment had stopped. And that's part of the problem in sort of showing a benefit years after you've stopped the treatment. This is the evaluations of these studies at the end of treatment. So in the James studies, they looked at chest x-ray changes at 6 months, and they found that if the people had disease of less than 2 years duration, so rather recent onset of sarcoid, there was an improvement of the chest x-ray. But in their total population, they could not show a benefit. It was only those who had disease duration of less than 2 years. In Israel's study, they used a combination of the chest x-ray, clinical symptoms, and spirometry at 3 months at the end of treatment, and showed that in people who had stage 2 or 3, these are people whose x-rays had evidence of involvement of the lung tissue itself on it, that there was a, using this combination of a clinical x-ray and spirometry, there was a significant improvement in these people, 53% versus 17%, who were not treated. This was the end of 3 months of therapy. And in the Slerus study, they looked at changes of the x-ray, the forced vital capacity, or the DLCO, which is a measure of the ability of oxygen to go from the airspace into the lungs. And they showed a significant improvement in all three of these parameters at the end of the treatment regimen at 7 months. However, these were not the endpoints of the study. The endpoints of the study were really after treatment stopped, what happened years later. And when they did this, it was more difficult to show any continued improvement beyond when people were on steroids. So I think the conclusions from these studies that corticosteroids given in doses between 5 and 40 milligrams a day, between 3 and 7 months, will actually improve the chest radiograph, improve the vital capacity, improve the DLCO, and improve symptoms. similar studies for other forms of sarcoid, for cardiac, CNS disease, severe skin disease, the pain and fatigue syndromes have really not been done. So we don't have any real data on that in terms of placebo-controlled trials. However, when they looked at these studies at follow-up, there was no evidence that corticosteroids leads to long-lasting improvement. So it made people feel better in the short term, but did it make any difference when steroids were stopped years later? However, there are two things that were noticed, that it may reduce the subsequent need for steroids in these people. And also, once the steroid trial was stopped, it was uncontrolled whether people remained on steroids or got steroids later. So it's hard to interpret these, I think, long-term findings of steroids. So Steroids are certainly shown associated improvement while the patient is on steroids, but whether there is continued improvement after the patient's off of steroids is really unknown. The second line therapies, methotrexate is probably the best example of it and has usually been shown in studies to be used as a steroid sparing drug, where you can reduce the dose of steroids and still maintain quality of life in patients. It's an anti-metabolite. It's a non-specific drug, as I think Ed has showed. We don't really know what the cause of sarcoid is. All our treatments are non-specific. They're aiming to reduce inflammation, which causes the granuloma formation. And this is an anti-metabolite that inhibits dihydrofolate reductase. Guidelines for its use in sarcoid have been recently published in the current opinion of pulmonary medicine. Its major concerns are liver toxicity, bone marrow suppression, and renal dysfunction. And because of this, blood studies have been done on a regular basis to monitor for toxicity. The drug only has to be given once a week, so it's relatively easy to take. And really has made a tremendous difference in the lives of a lot of patients. But unfortunately, sometimes methotrexate doesn't work, and one has to use other drugs. It's used to treat all forms of sarcoid, even though methotrexate doesn't is thought to penetrate the blood-brain barrier. It is still used in CNS disease. You need to monitor toxicity. And other similar drugs to this are azathioprine, mycophenolate, and leflunomide. I'm not going to go into any details on those because I don't think there's enough time, but they're all used interchangeably, essentially, as second-line drugs in the treatment of sarcoidosis. And then the other things that have made a tremendous difference recently are the anti-TNF drugs. These are drugs like Remicade or Humira that inhibit TNF-alpha. These are really considered third-line agents in sarcoidosis. These drugs tend to be very expensive. A lot of times, physicians have to make special appeals to the insurance companies to get them approved, as I think Alan sort of indicated in his talk that this is something that physicians who are interested in sarcoid are doing all the time because, again, these drugs haven't been specifically approved for the use of sarcoid by the FDA. It's, again, guidelines have been published on how to use these drugs in sarcoid, and this is certainly helpful for getting insurance companies to approve it. The major concerns about the TNF agents are infections because they're immunosuppressive, and certainly people can develop tuberculosis on it. They can develop other infections that have been a problem with these drugs. The drugs were also used in a series of cases for heart failure, not with people with sarcoid, but with heart failure in general, because it was thought that it might improve heart failure, and actually in a subpopulation, it made the heart failure worse. So it's people have used these drugs in cardiac sarcoid in rare cases. Again, there's no controlled series or large case series of it, but it does help some people with heart failure, so we can use it. But if somebody has severe heart failure from cardiac sarcoid, I think people are very cautious about using these drugs. And then, interestingly enough, these drugs can actually cause a syndrome that looks like sarcoid in rare cases. And it's been described in all of the TNF drugs. It's hard to know what this means. My suspicion is that it's because it's immunosuppressive, somebody probably gets an infection with some organism that normally doesn't cause a problem, and they get a delayed response to it, which is they get a granulomas response that looks like sarcoid. Usually stopping the drug makes that syndrome go away, though sometimes people have been treated with steroids with it also. We were involved. There have actually been three placebo-controlled trials using the anti-TNF drugs in sarcoid. This is the first trial that was done, and the first trial actually showed the greatest benefit. Unfortunately, this trial was stopped early because there was difficulty recruiting patients for the trial, and it required patients who had new onset of symptoms, who had been on steroids in the past and didn't want to go on steroids. And so these people required more treatment for their sarcoid because their symptoms were getting worse. And they were either given Remicade, infliximab, initially, or they had to wait approximately 6 weeks. They got a placebo instead and then got it. So you can see the red line here indicates the people who got Remicade initially, and you can see there's an immediate improvement. And the blue line shows those who got the placebo and then 6 weeks later got the Remicade, and you can see there's a delayed improvement. Unfortunately, because of the limited number of patients that were recruited for the study, and the drug company, Senecor, at the time wanted to do a larger study, they stopped the study early and did a second study. if you combine both groups, there's no significant difference between those two lines on the left there. But if you combine the two groups, looking at people both the placebo-controlled and the treatment groups, and before and after they actually got the Remicade, there was a significant improvement in their vital capacity, a change of approximately 10%, as you can see in the slide on the left. In the other two trials that were used with the anti-TNF drug, the inclusion criteria was slightly different. It wasn't people who had new onset of symptoms that required initial therapy, but it was people who had chronic symptoms who were on therapy and wanted to feel better. And when they did these studies in a placebo-controlled manner where people were either given a placebo or the real drug for a much longer period of time, so it wasn't like these people required treatment so you couldn't wait, you know, you couldn't wait 6 months before treating them. there was only a very small improvement. The improvement was significant, but it was only like 1 or 2%, which nobody thinks is really clinically relevant, that people could really notice that change. So unfortunately, the TNF drugs have not been approved by the FDA for the use in sarcoid, though they're used all the time for people who have severe disease, especially when other drugs fail and people are having side effects. The indications for the anti-TNF drugs, as I mentioned, are when other drugs fail, so it's used a lot for CNS disease. Matter of fact, because of its efficacy in CNS disease, people are very rapidly going to the anti-TNF drugs rather than waiting for steroids or methotrexate or other drugs like that to work. Severe eye disease, it's also used for severe skin disease. As I mentioned, lupus perneo, it can cause tremendous improvement where other drugs have failed for long times. And it's also used in lung disease and some of the fatigue and pain syndromes when other drugs fail. One of the things that's been interesting recently is the PET scan, as I assume a lot of people are familiar with, is a scan that's used to look at where there's active inflammation in the body and can show where there's active disease due to sarcoid. And this has been used in some cases prior to treatment with the anti-TNF drugs and may be something that may help justify the use of the anti-TNF drugs and may also identify a group of people who are more likely to respond to these drugs than others. As I think Ed has mentioned, if people have scarring in their lungs, there's nothing that we can do about scar tissue. We can't make the scar tissue in the lung or other organs go away. That has to clear up on its own if it can. If there's active inflammation, that hopefully we can treat. And the drugs, the two that are most used today are infliximab, otherwise known as Remicade, or adalimumab, which is known as Humira. So I think to summarize, there are many drugs that are used to control the symptoms of sarcoidosis. Unfortunately, there are very few controlled studies. So one of the major needs in sarcoid are better drugs with fewer side effects. If, you know, the studies, the grad studies that we're involved with at the University of Pennsylvania, as well as Hopkins and several other institutions, can find agents that are the cause of sarcoid, then maybe we can have actually specific therapy for this disease rather than the nonspecific therapy we're using. And we need studies designed to really prove the effectiveness of these drugs. And this requires patients being willing to enter studies. Certainly, the three large NIH-sponsored trials, the ACCESS study in the late 90s, the SAGA study, and now currently the GRAD study, has showed that institutions can collaborate to do large-term trials in sarcoid. Drug companies, because of this, have become more interested in doing drug trials in sarcoid, and the three TNF trials have shown that drug companies can do and can successfully recruit patients for studies in sarcoid. And I think more drug companies are becoming interested in doing trials. Certainly, the Foundation for Sarcoid Research is trying to encourage drug companies to do these trials, and we certainly need better drugs to treat sarcoid. So I think I'll end here, and I guess there will be questions at the end.
Yeah, I did want to ask one thing, just if you could address it, because I know that there has been some studies, not maybe enough studies, but on a particular drug that is FDA-approved right now, which is the Acthar, and have you... Have you had any experience, or do you know of any clinical trials that are working?
Acthar is a steroid-like drug. It's a corticotropin that is what the brain releases to tell the adrenals to produce more steroids. So basically, it is thought to have the same general side effects as corticosteroids. Whether it's more effective or less effective than corticosteroids is not really known. Certainly it was used and approved by the FDA in the 1950s when the FDA criteria for approving drugs was very lax compared to today's standards. And basically because the ease of using steroids, prednisone, versus corticotropin as it was known then, people stopped using it. It has been recently revived and in a new formulation, and there are some case series that are trying to be published. I've reviewed some but haven't come out in the literature yet that suggest that it may be useful in some cases, but again, its role in sarcoid is not known. It's not known whether it's any more effective or actually will reduce side effects of steroids, because the side effects of the drug are really the same as the side effects of corticosteroids.
Okay, also I did want to add one more thing. On Dr. Rossman's slide, he showed a website, and it's for the treatment protocol, and you can simply go to, that's on FSR's website, which is stopsarcoidosis.org. It's called the treatment protocol. It's also a mobile app, and so you could bring it into your doctor and show them or print it out or whatever. So hopefully that'll be a helpful resource. And I'd like to introduce now from Vanderbilt University, Alan Chang. Dr. Chang?
Thank you. I recognize some familiar faces out there, and it's an honor to be here. So for those who I've taken care of and continue to take care of, I'm actually not at Vanderbilt, and so don't worry.
Sorry.
I'm still in Baltimore. And so we'll probably, unless you know something I don't.
Oh, gosh, I'm so sorry.
No, but it's an honor to be here, and it's a terrific time. And as Ed and Milt mentioned in their sort of remarks, research is sort of the cornerstone in which we make progress, especially with conditions such as sarcoidosis, which very few people really truly understand the basis for. And there's been no more exciting time than now to do research, because there's sort of some new microscope that's been developed or some new technology that hasn't been discovered in the last 30 years. It's because people like you, or people like these patient constituency groups, such as FSR, who are sort of advocating the importance of progress in this area. And as many of you know, when Obamacare sort of was established, one of the outcroppings of Obamacare was establishing this thing called the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute, or they call it PCORI for short. And PCORI is designed specifically to focus research and focus academic pursuits that have the patient-centered sort of interests in mind. And groups like you and people like you who participate in these type of programs really help move those things forward. So I applaud you guys for being here. So let me sort of shift gears a little bit and maybe give you a little of an update on cardiac sarcoid. And as Alan mentioned, this is sort of a condition that not everybody gets, but when you do get it, it's certainly something to sort of pay attention to, because it's something that we all sort of have to keep our head above water on. I'm not going to go over sort of some of the basis for sarcoidosis that Ed mentioned. Again, this is sort of a condition that was initially recognized in the 1900s. And the etiology, as people have sort of talked about, is really, really not clear. But what we do know is that it involves the immune system, and somehow the immune system is awry in recognizing foreign versus not foreign things. And as you know, the immune system is important not only for us to fight infections and to combat those things, but it also is important for surveillance, for cancer and malignancies. And the reason why you and I all don't develop cancer every day from being exposed to the sun or some other type of toxin or stimulus is because the immune system is playing a part in getting rid of some of those things that may not necessarily be good for the whole body. Now, Sarcoidosis, since it's part of the immune system, can affect any part of your body. And as you know, we mentioned some of these places, and this is a picture of exactly where these places can be. It can affect your lungs, it can affect your skin, your eyes, your central nervous system, or the CNS for short. And those sort of lesions that Milt mentioned, those erythema nodosum, occurs along the sort of front aspects of the lower extremities. But by and large, the most common place for sarcoid to affect people, as you know, is in the lungs. And roughly 90 to 95% of people who have sarcoid have lung involvement. And so in that context, well, how many of these individuals actually have heart involvement? It's not that many. And there have been variable sort of estimates in terms of how many people have it. And they roughly range somewhere between sort of 3 to 4% to even as high as 25 to 30% in some of these autopsy reports. Now, when it affects the heart is not just sort of one blob of muscle, as most people like to think. There are actually different parts of the heart. There's four chambers in the heart. There's chambers on the top part of the heart, and there's chambers in the bottom part of the heart. And the bottom part of the heart is the working horse portion of the heart. That's sort of what you need to preserve in terms of its functionality and its ability to serve as a pump. And so when sarcoid affects the heart, it can affect actually any part of the heart. It can affect the top chambers, it can affect the bottom chambers. And when it does sort of affect the heart and lay scar down, that scar can actually be a nidus for developing arrhythmias or very fast heart rates that can actually compromise the functionality of your heart and ultimately result in something very, very serious called sudden death, where people are just walking down the street, minding their own business. All of a sudden, they develop this very, very fast arrhythmia. The heart stops, and you see the EMS guys from these movies bring the paddles on to shock people back into rhythm. And that's sort of the basis for why it's so important to recognize cardiac involvement from sarcoid if it does happen. Now, there's a couple of different things about this. As Milt mentioned, where sarcoid affects the body sort of changes how the therapy should be sort of focused and how people present in terms of symptoms and signs. And so cardiac sarcoid often occurs, at least in the United States, often occurs in the setting of other systemic manifestations. And what I mean by that is it's not common, at least in the United States, to have people just develop heart involvement and nothing else. And most of the patients that we see in our clinic have heart involvement as well as something else. Like they had some skin involvement in the past, they have lung involvement, and that's sort of the majority of things. And what's also interesting is that there seems to be a geographical distribution in the way cardiac sarcoid presents as well. And there was a recent study that was published in Circulation, which is a very reputable heart journal that we often sort of cite and look at. And they studied individuals with cardiac sarcoid for over a 20 to 25 year period. And what they found was amongst these people in Finland, about 67% of these individuals had just heart involvement. And that's actually very, very uncommon for us to see, because we actually see sort of involvement in many other organs in addition to the heart. And there's a couple of other sort of features that we've sort of observed, at least from our experience, is that the remission rates are not as high as what we typically see in other organ systems, and that the room for error is actually quite small. Because if you had a little bit of scar tissue develop in the lungs, well, there's a lot of lung tissue that can sort of compensate for that and provide you the necessary functionality of that organ. But if you develop a scar in the heart, then that's a nidus, as I mentioned earlier, for developing arrhythmias that can actually result in sudden death. And so we're very, very particular in making sure that we do everything we can to minimize sarcoid's sort of deposition of scar tissue, if you will, in the heart tissue. Now, what do we know about cardiac sarcoid? As I mentioned, it was originally sort of discovered in 1929, around the time of the Depression. And so if you go on Google, this is likely the study that the Google sort of spiders will sort of pull out and educate you on. Well, this was an autopsy series of about 113 individuals with known cardiac sarcoid. And look at this, 79% of people died of cardiac sarcoid-related causes. And among them, many of them died of SCD, or sudden cardiac death, about two-thirds of individuals who died. And so when you look at this report and you read the report and you read the conclusions, it's very, very ominous. It's actually very, very scary, because it almost looks like there's no hope involved if you do develop sarcoid. But you have to sort of also appreciate that there's been a lot of changes since then And this report actually was from 1977. So things are very, very different now, and I sort of want to sort of give you sort of some reasons for why that may be, and why there's sort of a lot more hope to sort of look for as opposed to sort of how gloomy and doomy this report may be. Well, one reason for the change in hope is that there's greater awareness. Now, since I think FSR has been around for 15 years or so, and for the last 2000, so there's been a lot of progress with regard to making sure that people are aware of this condition. There was a time when people couldn't even spell it, let alone know what the entity was. And this has caught not only the pulmonologist's attention, because most people develop lung conditions, lung disease from sarcoid, but also the cardiologist. This is a guideline paper. So it's a bunch of people sitting in a room, a bunch of cardiologists, and this, in fact, is from the American College of Cardiology, the American Heart Association, and the Heart Rhythm Society. So all these three societies had representatives come together in a room to make guidelines to determine who should get a defibrillator, who should get a pacemaker. And in this sort of 2008 guideline, what they do is they just basically list a bunch of sort of criteria for why a defibrillator should be implanted. And right at the bottom of the list, number 10, they write that a defibrillator or an ICD implantation is reasonable for patients with cardiac sarcoidosis and other entities. And this is sort of, it was an unprecedented thing, because all the prior versions of the guidelines had no mention whatsoever of cardiac sarcoid being a reason for getting a defibrillator. The second reason also is that there's better codification or better sort of standardization of what constitutes a diagnosis of cardiac sarcoid. The Japanese literature sort of established this in the early 90s, and they've been revised about 10 or so years ago. But basically very, very granular details in terms of when you should sort of think about cardiac sarcoid as a diagnosis and when it's not applicable. And this has really sort of caught a lot of people's attention and made more people aware of the fact that this is something to really put on the differential list when somebody comes in with a strange presentation or not a classic presentation. The third thing that we sort of also recognize is that it's really important to have immunosuppression on board. This is sort of a Japanese paper showing that patients who have cardiac sarcoid, if they're treated with steroids or not treated with steroids, at some point in the course of their therapy, do a lot better if they were treated with steroids, suggesting that, you know, suppressing the immune system to some degree can actually improve patient outcome over several years. And in the last couple sort of observations is that we're using these what we call advanced cardiac imaging modalities a lot more. And the two sort of classic examples of that is the MRI, the magnetic resonance imaging. Everybody's probably heard of someone who's had an MRI or have gotten through an MRI. It's a very sort of tubular structure. Those who are claustrophobic tend to not like that experience too much. But nevertheless, it gives us very, very good fidelity pictures of heart tissue. And this is sort of what an example of an MRI looks like. Here's a picture of, on the left on the panel A, is a picture that we got from one of our patients. And you can see sort of a dark, sort of almost a backward C there. That's what healthy cardiac tissue looks like. And in where that black arrow shows is a lighting up area of that sort of cardiac tissue. And that's what suggesting of scar tissue. And so when we see this, we're certainly concerned, especially sort of if it's in the septum. And this is sort of panel B is another picture in a different angle showing that whiteout of that area where it should have been completely black and otherwise healthy. And then as Ed mentioned also, the another modality that we're often using these days is this positron emission tomography, or PET scan for short. And this is designed specifically to look for areas of inflammation. And the MRI is designed specifically to look for areas of scar. And not only are we using these more often, but we're being smart about it. And we're being smart about it in a sense of trying to sort of apply these modalities in the way we understand the way the disease works. And so as Milt mentioned, the way cardiac sarcoid or the way sarcoidosis works in many respects is it starts with a little bit of inflammation. You know, something is sort of inflamed, the immune system's in there, and it's starting to wreak havoc. And then over time, as this inflammation sort of festers and persists, it can result in scar tissue or fibrosis of that tissue. And so if you can think of that sort of process as a continuum, these imaging modalities can sort of be laid over in this sort of fashion. So the PET scan is great for looking at inflammation. a little bit of scar, but more so inflammation than scar. And the MRI is really, really good for looking for scar tissue, maybe a little bit of inflammation in some of the other sort of techniques, but certainly more scar. So we're not just picking one or the other. We're sometimes using both to get a better sense of where in that spectrum a person's disease process is. And then more importantly, people have looked at these sort of MRI images and scar images and found that they actually sort of have an effect on patients' outcomes. So we're using these imaging modalities not only more commonly, but more frequently in any one given individual so that we can follow them. So before they develop symptoms, before they develop sudden death, we can actually nip those issues at the bud and address those concerns just either with like a defibrillator implantation or other medications that we may be able to use in the mix. And this is sort of what the way we think about or the way we sort of process a patient who potentially has cardiac sarcoid. And I would want to stress more importantly that this is really a work in progress. And it's because of research that we're constantly being able to tweak this. But nevertheless, we do have sort of some method to our madness in terms of figuring out what to do. And this will change. And if we sort of talk maybe 5 years from now, this will probably be very, very different than what I'm showing you here. But in the end, the goal of this all is to sort of identify those individuals with sarcoid, or more specifically with cardiac sarcoid, who can develop this little tracing here. This is an EKG tracing of one of those sudden cardiac death rhythms where the heart is not beating and it's basically stopped. And the hope is with additional research and additional efforts from both researchers like these guys here as well as you, that we can be able to sort of risk stratify patients and really sort of improve patient outcomes in the long run. All right, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you again, Dr. Chang. I guess I was trying to make you commute much farther. I don't know. Sorry about that. The next expert we have up is, Colin Lignan. I have not met Dr. yet, but he is also from Johns Hopkins, I think. Right.
So my name is Colin Ligon. I'm one of the rheumatology fellows at Johns Hopkins. So coming at this from a little bit different aspect, I've had a long-standing interest in sarcoidosis. I had it in a family member when I was young. So I feel like I've grown up with a lot of this research, and I appreciate some of what Dr. Chang was talking about. It seems like things have certainly come a long way. But I've had the fortune of working with Dr. Chen in the sarcoidosis clinic, and I think we run into a certain situation enough that it piques our interest as scientists and as medical providers, but also brings up this issue of something that I think we would like to try to take some of the pain and uncertainty out of. I think very often by the time we see patients in specialty centers in the sarcoidosis clinics, people have gotten any number of diagnoses, oftentimes many of them, at the same time. And it can leave, understandably, a lot of uncertainty and even, distrust, at what point you trust all these diagnoses that you keep getting handed. So I wanted to explain a little bit about where that seems to come from, this phenomenon, particularly in sarcoidosis, where people do often seem to have two unrelated diseases that shouldn't, as far as we know, be linked, though we certainly do see it. Much of this talk is from a big picture. Unfortunately, I don't have all the answers, but I think it does help to know that this problem is out there, and I hope I'll be able to answer any questions. So just to start off outlining the problem, this is a patient that a few of us have seen at Johns Hopkins, where a middle-aged African-American lady that I follow in clinic had a long-standing history of pulmonary sarcoidosis that had really been very well controlled. Initially just had some fatigue and some shortness of breath, had biopsies, looked like sarcoidosis, no reason to suspect anything unusual. Subsequently, she developed some joint pain and swelling in the hands and the feet. We checked some blood work, as we do in rheumatology clinic, and she had a whole slew of positive antibodies. Now, antibodies are helpful in making diagnoses and pointing us to certain diagnoses, But one thing I want to talk about in a little bit is really what those antibodies mean and how often we see them, even in the absence of the disease that we think of when we hear these antibodies mentioned. So in her case, she had a positive rheumatoid factor. She had a positive CCP. Both of these are associated with rheumatoid arthritis. And the CCP, the kind of the teaching that you know, we all learn in medical school is that if someone has a CCP positive blood work, then chances are that they have a rheumatoid arthritis. This is supposed to be a specific test, meaning if it's positive, there's not much else that should cause it. She also had this ANA that was positive. This is a antibody that circulates in the blood that is found almost in everybody with lupus, but is also found in many patients that don't have lupus. And then lastly, she also had this SCL70 antibody. Now, this is an antibody that usually we see in patients with scleroderma. And much like the CCP positive antibody, it's supposed to be pretty specific for scleroderma. If you see an SCL70 antibody, there's not a lot of other conditions that we usually think about that's causing that kind of autoimmune response. So she ended up with a diagnosis of sarcoidosis, which we thought was well controlled, and then rheumatoid arthritis. And I'll get into a little bit more detail how we gave her the second label, but it certainly seems to be a very valid second diagnosis in her case. I don't know if any of you have ever heard the story about Roy Sullivan. Coming back to the title of my talk, this poor guy carries the dubious distinction of having the most lightning strikes of anybody alive. So he was hit by lightning 7 times. He survived all of them. But I think he's a good cautionary tale at what can happen with this feeling of helplessness and not understanding why all these terrible things are happening to somebody when you don't understand where they're coming from. His friends would stop being around him whenever there was a storm nearby. He was afraid to go anywhere if there was a storm anywhere. And supposedly, there were a couple of his lightning strikes where he actively felt like he was being chased by thunderstorms. He would be in his car and still struck by lightning while in his car. This kind of thing seems to happen sometimes. So just to talk a little bit more about how we diagnose rheumatologic diseases, it's a multi-step process. And in rheumatology, maybe more so than many diseases, where we have a simple single blood test that kind of answers the question, or say an EKG that shows typical changes in the heart, we really have to examine patients closely and tie in their test results with how they look. So the top picture here is a picture of a scleroderma hand, and this is a disease where patients develop scarring in the skin that can be very disfiguring and very limiting in terms of what patients can do. It also has many different flavors, so fortunately is not always progressive or particularly problematic. But then you can contrast that with the picture below it of a rheumatoid arthritis patient who has typical changes in the knuckles. This is a fairly characteristic change that happens with rheumatoid arthritis. So these patients could have any number of blood tests come back positive for one thing or another, but really when you see this kind of appearance on their exam and you talk about their story and it seems to fit the story of the disease, that's usually enough to really make that diagnosis. So then we augment that with other tests, and we like to draw fluid out of joints. Not just because it's gratifying immediately for patients and you really feel like you're doing something. There's not a lot in medicine, having gone a different branch than the surgical route, there's not a whole lot that we get to do at the bedside that makes patients feel better immediately. But this is one of them. Sometimes we can take fluid off of a painful joint, inject some steroids, and patients can get a lot better. But that fluid can also tell us a lot. Similarly, doing blood tests helps give us more information. Oftentimes imaging changes are characteristic enough to help us kind of cinch the diagnosis. And then lastly, just like sarcoidosis, we have to rule out other causes for autoimmune disease. Infections probably being the most common thing that we need to rule out, particularly because with our rheumatologic autoimmune diseases, just like sarcoidosis, we tend to treat with immunosuppressing medications. So the danger there is if you're missing an infection, that can make the infection worse if you suppress the immune system. And in fact, patients don't have autoimmune disease. So this is just a list of some of the viruses that can cause joint pains and swelling and skin rashes and other things that, that look like our autoimmune diseases. Similarly, sometimes cancers and even non-cancerous bony proliferations. This small picture here is a picture of enchondromas of the hand. Some patients have familial tendencies to develop these things. Some patients do have cancers that can cause pain, swelling, other things that sound like rheumatologic disease. And then when those three pieces come together, we can make that diagnosis of their individual autoimmune disease. The autoimmune diseases that I'm talking about are the rheumatologic diseases. There are a whole slew of autoimmune diseases, including thyroid disease, neurologic disease like myasthenia gravis. Those kinds of things we don't deal with a lot in rheumatology unless there's diagnostic uncertainty. So I'm referring mostly to what we call connective tissue diseases, and these are autoimmune diseases where the body is attacking joints, ligaments, other that fibrous kind of connective tissue that makes up the body. And there's about a handful of these kinds of diseases. So to look into this, the unusual thing about the possibility of a patient having multiple of these diseases is that relatively they are uncommon. Rheumatoid arthritis is probably the most common of these, about 1% of the population. If you just pick somebody out of the population at random in the United States, is bound to have a diagnosis of rheumatoid arthritis. And then really, as you can see, the prevalence goes down from there. Certainly, racial, gender factors are all important in epidemiology of these autoimmune diseases. They do all tend to be generally more common among women and among African Americans, generally speaking. And you can see, so the chances of having something like sarcoidosis, even with the most common autoimmune disease that we deal with in rheumatology, being rheumatoid arthritis, you're looking at less than 1 in a million chance. Now, I suppose if you take 300 million patients in the United States, yes, that does amount to a good number of people that can have both. But people have kind of looked at this, and the literature does seem to support, I think many physicians feel like we see these things happen together more often than you would expect. And the literature kind of supports that. Going all the way back to the 1950s, the study here I was going to share with you is a study by Mark Judson, where this is the most recent one that's really looked at this. And they found 15 patients among kind of a combined group of patients they'd seen at Albany and at MUSC, where he was previously. Out of those, the majority of them actually were diagnosed with sarcoidosis after the connective tissue disease. That's bound to be a little bit skewed because if you're familiar with Dr. Judson, he's certainly a well-known sarcoidologist, and one would suspect that many of these patients are coming out of his clinic. Where these patients come from oftentimes affects the characteristics of the disease and the timing that they've developed these things. But the other thing he pointed out was that a substantial proportion of these patients had sarcoidosis of one organ. We usually think of sarcoidosis as a multi-organ disease. So his argument was that it's possible these patients just have a limited immune response that's awry due to the connective tissue disease, actually, and doesn't really reflect a true sarcoidosis as we usually think of it. Our experience has maybe been, I think, a little bit that this is more common even than the literature would suggest. When he looked through all the published studies over the last 100 years and in our online databases, they found 53 patients in total that had a diagnosis of both of these. I suspect your personal experience also may reflect that that probably underestimates how many patients are being told that they have both. We looked at our own records at Johns Hopkins, and we'd seen just about 50 patients over the last 3 years that seemed to carry diagnoses of both of those. So, why does this happen more frequently than we would expect? There can be a number of reasons. Certainly, there's a diagnostic overlap. Many of our autoimmune diseases have a lot in common with sarcoidosis, so it can be hard to tease these things out. That's further exacerbated by the fact that these are often clinical diagnoses. So when you're making a diagnosis off of symptoms, and you have two diseases that share a lot of symptoms, it can be a little bit muddy in deciding which diagnosis to assign. The side effects of treatment sometimes for either set of diseases can lead to the others. And I'll talk about more about that in a little bit. And then I think the bigger questions that we haven't really sorted out, because they are very big questions, there's a lot of immune changes happening. And these things are happen together infrequently enough that it's hard to really look at this patient population closely. But I think the question of whether one of these diseases is predisposing to another one is a very valid one. You know, when the autoimmune system is abnormal, it can change really the way that your body interacts with all the components of your immune system, of your blood vessels, of your connective tissue. And then lastly, genetics contributing to both. I think increasingly we're understanding some of the subtleties of the immune system. With our genome-wide association studies now, we're able to sequence large parts of the human genome and look for certain proteins that are being expressed more than we would expect. We haven't found a lot of overlap between sarcoidosis and autoimmune disease so far, but I'll show you some of what has been coming out of that. So this is a big table with, hopefully is showing, I was afraid of that. I think the screen I was assembling this on is a little bit smaller than the screen that I'm showing it to you on. So I think all the important parts of this are here. The titles across the top are the first few, the ANA, rheumatoid factor, and CCP. Those are common autoantibodies, meaning they're immune proteins circulating in the blood that react to components of our own body, you know, that they really have no business interacting with. We've historically associated these antibodies with specific diseases, as I kind of mentioned earlier. And this goes to show you that there really isn't any one antibody that is particularly reassuring against any other autoimmune disease. You really have to put these things into context. I think probably the best ones to show you, so first of all, the top row being sarcoidosis there, you can see that many patients have ANA positivity, which is, I think, one way that oftentimes patients come to us with a diagnosis of lupus at the same time as sarcoidosis, which may not really be borne out clinically. And then you bearing in mind that really up to 70% of patients have complaints of joint aching, you know, a substantial proportion of those patients having actual joint swelling, really indistinguishable from rheumatoid arthritis, autoimmune arthritis, you can see how it would be easy to assign patients both diagnoses and oftentimes appropriately, honestly, you know, in terms of how we treat patients. Some of the, these are highlighting some of these characteristic antibodies and clinical features that we associate with other diseases that are still found very commonly in sarcoidosis. You know, every disease I think that we deal with has it. Rheumatoid arthritis has these antibodies that are frequently found in sarcoidosis. Scleroderma has the ANA positivity. Myositis, there are autoimmune forms of muscle attacks. We know that a vast majority of patients, if you go taking pieces out of their muscle, doing muscle biopsies, even if they don't have any complaints, they will often have muscle changes. Fortunately, the frequency of actual muscle weakness and inflammation really enough to change muscle enzyme levels is substantially lower, but we know all these things are there. Finally going down into Sjogren's syndrome, oftentimes distinguishing between sarcoidosis and Sjogren's can be very difficult. They both tend to attack the glands. The salivary glands are a common place that both can attack, and really oftentimes a biopsy is needed to distinguish those. The literature does have a number of reports of patients with both of those, so that may not be as clean-cut a distinction as it could be. And then to go back to the drugs that oftentimes overlap in these diseases, we don't use a lot of the antiarrhythmics that we used to, I think more commonly would cause a lupus-like syndrome. But I suppose in sarcoidosis, you heard a little bit about anti-TNF alpha treatment. Fortunately, I don't want to scare anybody because these reactions are very rare, but they're used very commonly in our autoimmune diseases too. These are one of our, even in certain cases, frontline treatments for rheumatoid arthritis. Most of the anti-TNF-alpha treatments have been associated with the sarcoid-like reaction that we don't really fully understand the ins and outs of. People have kind of hypotheses of where that comes from. And then oftentimes, you know, patients with sarcoidosis have any number of other medical issues that do end up getting treated with these things. Hydralazine is a common blood pressure medication that we use. Minocycline and doxycycline are medications that usually have some immune quieting effects. So sometimes that can be a beneficial thing to try for mild joint disease. Unfortunately, they can also cause drug-induced lupus. Immunology, this is, I was laughing when they were showing their sophisticated pictures of the immune system. This is my graphic here. But the take home is that these things are all complicated, and many of them change over time. So there's probably an evolution in many of these diseases. I think sarcoidosis being one of them. We see it also in scleroderma is probably a good example of another a problem that can start out as a very inflammatory type of immune response, and then later turns into a scarring kind of problem. Those two things happen kind of by different immune system pathways and require a little bit different treatment. But each of these have some characteristics that look like each other at various stages. So it's not inconceivable that some of these problems may be driving each other. In lupus, there's this interferon alpha is a signaling molecule that causes a lot of anti-cell type immune responses. It's one of the ways the body fights off tumors. It fights off viral infections. That often occurs early in sarcoidosis with elevations in those kinds of signals. In scleroderma, there's this IL-33 increase. That's a signal in the immune system that seems to predispose to scarring. Rheumatoid arthritis and psoriatic arthritis, some of these what are called seronegative spondyloarthritides, have this IL-17 signature that's recently been increasingly targeted by specific antibodies. But IL-17 seems to also potentially play a role. We see different levels of expression of IL-17 in sarcoidosis. It's not entirely clear, I suppose, as to whether this is a good thing or a bad thing. Patients with oftentimes good outcomes have high levels of IL-17. It may hang around a little bit longer than it should in sarcoidosis. And then lastly, the genetic associations. This is a little bit of an alphabet soup, mostly to show you that a lot of things have been looked at and not much has really come out. There doesn't seem to be a lot of overlap. These DR, B, DQ, B abbreviations are names that they place on the genetic protein changes that make up the immune components of the kind of the protein recognition system in the body. And the thought is that people that have immune receptors that are made up of very certain protein sequences can kind of misread the environment or react more frequently than somebody without those protein sequences to the body where they shouldn't be reacting to and can drive some of these autoimmune problems. And we see this within diseases where each of these diseases are associated with certain ones of these changes, but we don't see a lot of overlap. Some of the other more specific components of the immune system, we have seen some changes. I think the toll-like receptor 2 complex is a good example. Dr. Chen may have shared with you earlier about the amyloid recognition. There are certain receptors in the body that are primed to respond to the parts of the environment that your body doesn't need any time to develop immune system reactions to. And those things you are found, mutations in those are often found in sarcoidosis, and increasingly we're finding them in other diseases as well. So then just the last thing I wanted to share with you, fibromyalgia is something we see a lot in rheumatology. This isn't, as far as we can tell, an autoimmune disease, and this is probably one of them that seems to be pretty valid. We see fibromyalgia so commonly with our other diseases. Unfortunately, there's, I think, a lot of popular misconception about fibromyalgia. our understanding is kind of woefully incomplete right now. I think every couple months we hear something really exciting from the research world about what seems to be causing it, what puts people at risk, and what kind of treatments are promising. But we have a long ways to go. But this is a clinically diagnosed disease where patients seem to be, where individuals are particularly responsive to stimuli that shouldn't be painful. So light touches, moving around, things that ordinarily you wouldn't think would be particularly painful. In fibromyalgia, they can be very painful. They can be very debilitating. And unfortunately, they can make it difficult to walk around, really live the fullness of one's life. The treatments, the key, I think probably even more than any medication, is really staying active. This is an example of something, where I always have to laugh at myself a little bit. I try to teach people Tai Chi exercises that they can do. I think I'm probably kind of an unlikely expert for Tai Chi, but fortunately there's a lot of free videos online. If anyone just goes to YouTube and does a search for Tai Chi, they have free hour-long videos by Tai Chi instructors. And Tai Chi has been shown to substantially reduce. Doing about 2 hours a week was even enough to substantially reduce pain and improve function in fibromyalgia, which we see across all of our immune diseases. And that's probably related to patients being sick and being able to be less active, and that predisposes patients to developing fibromyalgia. So there's, I think, a lot of future things that need to be examined with this association. I think we're still learning a lot about where these diseases, autoimmune diseases, come from. And as we learn more about that and more about where sarcoidosis comes from, we'll be able to understand how to abort some of these processes early on. But I think it would still be helpful for us to figure out really when these diseases, how they're occurring in relation to sarcoidosis, better understand whether one seems to be generating another, whether it's true overlap, or whether there are kind of immune predispositions. So, thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Doctor, and thank you to all the doctors for sharing their knowledge. We're running a little bit late, but we're still going to do a break. We'll do a 10-minute break, and we'll start up with the question and answer session.